This is my flock. I keep them. Care for them. I feed them.
Feed them?
With what?
What do you feed them?
Flesh! I deliver you unto Satan's creatures for the destruction of your flesh, that your spirit may be safe. May God have mercy on your soul.
Hi, I'm Michael Bassett, writer and director of Solomon Kane. Welcome to part of the conversation about Solomon Kane and other things on the AV forums. Thank you very much indeed. Website/TV channel. I'm interviewing Chris and Simon. And it's been a pleasure so far, I can tell you that for nothing. First question.
It's a nice widescreen image that you've got there, 2.35:1, I think, yep. I presume most of it. How'd you set up these quite large shots?
You cleverly set this up by getting very, very good crew who know exactly what they're doing. You know, I mean, it sounds like a flip response, but the truth of the matter is that I'm responsible as the director for the entirety of the movie, and acting and the writing, because I wrote it, the look, everything about it is filtered through me. But, you know, I want good-looking movies. I mean, I'm a huge fan of Ridley Scott, because I think he makes the best-looking pictures in the world. And it seems to me, if you're going to go to the trouble of making a movie, you might as well make it look great. You know, it should look like a piece of filmmaking, and not just a camera sitting there recording the activity. I want the camera to be part of the process. So I wanted a DP, director of photography, also called a cinematographer, who's going to photograph the film in a way which makes it look beautiful in accordance with my wishes. Now, I used a guy called Dan Lauston, who also shot Brotherhood of the Wolf and Silent Hill, and he's a fantastic DP. And I really, really wanted him for this, so I went to see him where he lives in Copenhagen, explained what I wanted to do. He said, that sounds like my kind of movie. And we got together and talked about it. So the process of getting the look of the movie was a collaboration, and partly because I'm a trained photographer as well. I can talk to a certain extent about lenses and lighting and exposures and how something will look and feel and the physical aspects of moving the camera and composing a scene through shots.
So he can't exactly blind you with science, can he? Because you know a fair bit about it.
Absolutely. Yourself. I mean, and I think what you want to do is have somebody who can collaborate, but I also want to have a guy who by a week into the shoot will understand how I'm likely to shoot a scene and say, I'm going to offer you up this, this and this, so that I can then go and talk to the actors. Because what I really want to do on a movie is be so prepared walking onto the set from a technical point of view. So I've storyboarded the scenes. Where necessary, I've done previs. So the camera moves are known, the lens packages are known, the lighting is known. So that's controlled. Yeah. And then I can be flexible with the actors. Because that's where it comes to life.
Well, it frees you up then, doesn't it?
It frees you up, because what you want is you want the performance. What people look at in a movie is not the... They absorb the feel of the movie, they absorb the beauty and the style. But what they're really looking at is the people. Yeah. They're connecting with the people.
The story.
Yeah. I think that's why Avatar is a really interesting movie. Not only is it the most successful film ever made right now, it also is entirely about the look. And yet you have to connect with the blue cap people. You've got to. That's the only way into this story. No matter how fantastic it looks, and it does look amazing, unless you get the blue cap people to behave in a way which you can relate to, you're not going to go with
the
movie.
It's just set dressing otherwise.
It is just set dressing. So that's what you're always trying to do. So in a very circuitous way of answering your question, is that you've got to make sure that the guys you're collaborating with, the lighting director, you know, the grips even, everybody who's involved in the photography of the movie. Because that's the thing that is the key, and it goes through from shooting it on the set into post-production, how it's cut, and then how it's graded, and then how it's transferred back onto film. Because that's, I mean, the things I've learned about on this movie, because I hadn't worked with so many special effects before now, it's about the problems of getting effect shots to composite properly onto film, so that all the levels of black look right and everything sits perfectly, and then that's transferred to your film, and you look at it on film and it's projected finally, and you've got this wonderful fresh negative, and you think it's going to look so fantastic, and you go, ooh, it looks a bit magenta, because the chemical bath in the lab that morning has been a little bit magenta, you know, and that's because photography is still an organic chemical process. You know, it starts organic and chemical because I shot Kane on film and not digital. It becomes digital once it goes into the special effects houses and the grading, and then it goes back to being organic again at the end of the day on film. And that's, you know, those parts of the process actually aren't terribly compatible, and it's a real struggle making the film look exactly how you want. And there is a point where you just go, you know what, I'm never going to get it so perfect. There's got to be a cut-off point. Well, because the labs will only process the film so many times before they say, no, you've had your lot.
But to go back to the inevitable
Blu-ray
release, how much say do you have in the final look of that? Do you sign that off, the actual visual look of that?
Wow. Well, you know, I actually can't answer that question because that is a future question, because I haven't done the Blu-ray transfer of this movie yet. You know, we're still in the middle of the theatrical release. Every step of the way, I've signed off on the look and the sound, you know, the presentation of the picture. That, you know, nothing has gone out until I've said, I'm happy with it. Now, sometimes it's been, they've said, you're not going to get it any better than this. So you might as well sign off on it. And I'm like reluctantly going, okay, it's fine. You know, we spent a lot of time on the sound of the movie. And we did several passes on the sound because we just couldn't get to the place we wanted to be. I wanted big. I wanted a big, epic, very American kind of sound mix on it.
Well, even the version that we saw, and it's got a quite an aggressive sound mix.
Yeah, absolutely. On that. Wanted big. Yeah. I wanted big because the sound actually helps present the movie as a big movie.
Of course.
And obviously got a fantastic score by Klaus Badelt, who I, you know, I'm so delighted we got him on board, certainly.
I was going to ask you about Klaus Badelt, he's another protege of Hans Zimmer, isn't
that's
he?
Right, that's right. So Klaus came on board. I mean, I love his score for Pirates of the Caribbean. I love his quieter stuff as well. And he, you know, he really likes the movie and did a great job for me. So, you know, getting everybody, the sonically and visually, getting it to come together. And you never really see the two perfect aspects in the same place. You know, the perfect grade is the last day of the grade in a digital theatre somewhere in London, and the film will never look better than that. It's the best predictor. Everything's the industry standard across the board, the highest and most expensive quality equipment you can get, best look of the movie, but there's no damn sound on that, right? Because you're just working with the visuals, right? The best sound mix is going to be in a great big mixing theatre a few doors down, which is just a crappy video projection. And you never really see those two perfect elements come together. You know, they do come together, but by that stage, they've both lost a sort of pseudo-digital generation. Mm-hmm. You know, and then it goes on to film, and then you sign up for the film. And for me, the film transfer is a really interesting thing because of this chemical discrepancy. But also, film looks different from digital. You know, and I wasn't a big fan of digital projection until I finally saw the digital projection of Solomon Kane. I saw it at the screening room in Fox in London, and it's the best I've ever seen this movie look. I was stunned. Wow. You know, so I'm moving towards this sense of digital being the way ahead. Yeah. I'm still not sure about shooting on it yet. And in terms of the Blu-ray transfer, you know, hopefully I'm going to sign off on that as the time comes for the DVD transfer. And then the Blu-ray, you know, of course I want it to look as good as it possibly can. Otherwise, what the hell was the point in all the effort?
It's still your creation, isn't it? That's you're stamping your mark on it. It's your movie.
Yeah. But it's a collaborative thing. Aren't you? 150 people plus have worked on the movie at some point, and everything they've contributed, you know, makes a difference. I'm sort of the arbiter of what I think is right and wrong. It has filters through my sensibility, but you know, they all come along and do their work.